And foolproof minute rice for perfect rice every time.
7:30, David Hartman, Joan London. When the Beatles broke up, each of the four went their separate musical ways. Since then, the most consistently successful at both writing and performing music has been Paul McCartney. I recently had the pleasure of having a long conversation with Paul McCartney about the Beatles, about his own career, his own life, which we will be showing you over the next few days. In a few minutes, the first part of my conversation with Paul McCartney.
Then we are going to talk with a football coach who hasn't had a whole lot to cheer about this season. There's his team. We are going to be talking with Hugh Campbell of the Houston Oilers. They have lost the last 8 games. Also, Joel Siegel will review a new movie from Brian De Palma, who, of course, usually directs creepy, crawly movies. Right now, though, it is 7:30, and Steve Bell has the news for us. Steve, good morning.
Good morning, Joan. Good morning, everyone.
NFL season, and by this point, most...
That it's very close to normal.
Thanks.
Someone knocking at the door. Somebody ringing a bell. Someone's knocking at the door. Somebody's ringing a bell. Do me a favor. Open the door. And let them in.
Oh, Harry, with your cigars and these musty odors, we need new Arm & Hammer Maximum Strength Carpet Deodorizer.
I need never care. What's another is to need her everywhere.
For over 29 before 9 right now, 9 before 8 right now, for over 20 years now, Paul McCartney has been making music first with and then without the Beatles. Critics have sometimes made some unfavorable comparisons to his more recent work, but in the new movie, Give My Regards to Broad Street, Paul mixes McCartney and Beatles tunes side by side. And this morning, the first part of my four-part interview with Paul McCartney, he talks about how this mix, this movie, came to be.
It was a kind of basic thing. It was basically an entertainment thing rather than a kind of deep, structured, you know, thing. It was really just to kind of create a pleasant evening out for people.
All right, you've strung together, in a sense, a lot of your, you know, great hit songs, and you perform them, and at the same time, new songs you've written, and you perform those, and you put them together on the screen. Why? What was the idea behind that? The old and the new.
Oh, the old and the new. That was the director.
But you wrote it, so I mean, you were in control of it.
No,
so
well, actually, what I did was when I wrote the script, I wrote opportunities for music to happen. I kind of said, comes into room and sits down and then sings music 3.
Yeah.
So I didn't actually sort of choose the songs there. I just left them open. I left it to him being the director. And I kind of said, what do you fancy here? And he'd say, well, you know, we're at a film studio at this point in the thing. I'd really like to do a big production number here. And I've got my eye on such and such a song. Can we do that one?
Right.
So, for instance, that particular thing, he chose a song called Ballroom Dancing.
Ballroom Dancing.
I gave him a list of about 50 songs. I said, you know, I've written one or two, but these are like the 50 that I'd be happy right now to sing. Either I haven't sung them for a long time, or I'm kind of rediscovering them, or I took a look at the words of that, and it seemed quite nice. So I gave him ones that I was up for singing, and then said, well, you know, you can kind of choose according to your various reasons. Some of the reasons were for plot reasons.
Right.
I do Yesterday in it, and I said to him, I'm really going to do that again, am I, you know? Good old favorite. He said, well, you know, people want to hear it. And he said, but in the script, there's a plot reason.
Was the original title of that song really Scrambled Eggs?
Baby, How I Love Your Legs. That was it,
How much of that do you remember? I was shocked when I was Scrambled Eggs.
Scrambled Eggs. Baby, how I love your legs. I believe in Scrambled Eggs. That's what it
really
was, yeah. Well,
really?
I didn't have any lyrics, in truth, yeah. That's that one. But what happened was I just, some songs, they come so easily that they fool you. You think you mustn't have written it. And with Yesterday, I'd been asleep, and I kind of woke up, and I almost fell out of bed, and there was a piano by my bed. And I just had this tune in my head. Started writing it on the piano, you know, started playing the chords, and I thought, I haven't written this. I've just dreamt it, and someone else has written. So I went around for about 3 weeks before I dared put any lyrics to it, asking people, say, where have you heard this before? This I haven't, but it's quite a nice tune. I said, no, come on, you know, we must have heard it before. I've heard it before. And when I found out it wasn't, then I put some lyrics on it.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday.
Are the best songs that you have written the ones that came out like that, or are there some good ones that you really had to sweat over?
I think maybe the best ones come out like that, because they just drop out, you know?
Oh, I believe in yesterday. Mm-hmm.
Where did Rigby come from? How did that come about?
I was in Bristol, wandering around the town, and I saw a shop called Rigby's. And I've always been one, I like names. I like what names do. You know, they suggest something about the person. And I put Eleanor with it, and then dreamed up this idea of a kind of lonely old spinster whose face was in the jar by the door, and it wasn't going to work out for her, and it was a kind of a sort of lonely, sad thing.
Eleanor Rigby picks up the rice in the church where her wedding was being. Lives in a dream, waits at the window, wearing the face that she keeps in a jar by the door. Who is it for? All the lonely people, where do they all come from?
More with Paul McCartney tomorrow and early next week. And we'll be right back after this. 4 minutes.
One time ago, your mother should know. Your mother should know. If you break my heart, I'll go. But I'll be back again. Cause I told you once before goodbye. But I came back again.
Pictures, 10 of 9, the Beatles, so many haunting songs that have become standards now. Some of those songs are recalled in the new movie, Give My Regards to Broad Street, today in the second part of my interview with Paul McCartney. He talks about his feelings about John Lennon and John's widow, Yoko Ono, about how his songwriting has changed through the years, about how Ringo, George, and John and the early days together.
Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better.
I think that probably my work then was kind of coming out easier. It was easier to work for me because it was more novel. I was working with a guy called John Lennon too, who let us not forget. And he's one smart cookie, a boy. So it was very much easier. It was twice as easy as it is now to write with John. Because I would come up with a kind of dumb line, and he would just say, that's a dumb line. You know, and I'd do the same with him. That was really our strength. I remember I had a line which was, she was just 17. She'd never been a beauty queen. That was my line. Okay, and he went, big elbow for that. And so we worked a little harder. We got to, she was just 17, you know what I mean. Which was much better.
Well, she was just 17.
Looking back over that period, it's many years ago now. How do you describe that time? Hysteria.
Hazy. For me, I mean, it's hazy because it's as if you had a ring at the end of your nose and you're just being pulled around, you know. And we didn't mind. It wasn't a bad thing. I mean, you had to do it that way because otherwise you would have had to just have this list in your mind about where you were going to. So it was pretty frantic life. You know, you go from gig to hotel, from hotel to plane, from plane to car. Car to hotel, hotel to gig.
What about John? I know you're quoted as saying that the relationship you had with him when he died wasn't as good as you would like it to have been. Mm. How have you come to terms with all of that?
Well, I haven't really. I don't think you do, really. Round about, I think it was about 69 or something, the group, the Beatles, just broke up, and we got into a lot of business disarray, and there were various people really on our case, you know, from kind of, because there's a lot of money knocking around and we didn't have it organized at all. So we got into a lot of business hassles, as I think a lot of people know, and that hurt our friendships because then we started to sort of split apart. But the one consolation for me was that although for the last 10 years of John's life, we hadn't really been tight. And in fact, we'd had a lot of these business hassles. The great thing was that the very last phone call I happened to make with him, I happened to speak with him, we didn't talk one bit about business. It was all just about family. It was about kids. It was really warm and it was fabulous. It was like the best phone conversation of the whole 10 years. So, I mean, I thank heaven for small mercies, really.
What about Yoko? Do you see her? Do you talk with her? Are you...
A little bit, you know. I don't really know her too well. I didn't know her too well at the time. No. John was the one who knew Yoko, really. You know, that it was John's, she was John's lady and love. And we had to respect that. I think at first we had a lot of problem because it was breaking up the old gang, you know, Wedding Bells, breaking that old gang of mine. But you can't say to two people who are in love, listen, the Beatles is more important than your love. And we were all aware that we couldn't say that. She's a nice lady, you know, but I never did get on that well kind of thing. So I think it's a kind of fake to just saying, oh, she's great. We really get on. We really chat and stuff. She's good, you know, but I think we don't see eye to eye on some things.
Filling out the Beatles thing, George, how is George? Do you see George? What's George doing?
George is wonderful. He's fine. George does a lot of film stuff. He produces films. He is to do with films like Time Bandits and stuff like that.
Ringo.
Ringo is Ringo.
What does that mean?
So you tell me.
You're the one that's supposed to know.
Yeah, no, Ringo's just always been exactly the same as he ever sort of was, except he's kind of learned a bit more through the years about, well, I don't know, you kind of eat it in French restaurants and that kind of thing that you do learn, you know. But basically, he's just the same guy he ever was. You know, Ringo, he's just a head case. He's great, though. I mean, don't take that the wrong way. He's a great fella.
Do you envision writing with it? Do you write with anybody else now?
Yeah, occasionally. But, I mean, I don't think I'd try and get a collaborator in the same way as John and I kind of hooked up. Because it would be really looking for the Holy Grail, you know. It's not easy. It wouldn't be easy for anyone else to fill his shoes either, you know.
Paul McCartney, more with Paul next week. And it's 5 Up. We'll be right back.